pag-uusapan ngayon, subalit nakafocus tayo sa ilang mga current events sapagkat sa mga oras na ito, nagbibilangan na ng boto sa Estados Unidos. Pagkatapos, si Pangulong Duterte aalis na naman patungong Malaysia at dumalaw na siya sa ilang mga bansa dito sa ASEAN at sa Asia tulad po ng China at ng Japan. So magbibigay ng kanilang mga pananaw ang ating mga panauhin. Pero merong isang burning issue of the day. Ito po yung desisyon ng Court Suprema. Napakaganda rin pag-usapan nito sapagkat may kinalaman nito sa kasaysayan.
Ayan, Nicola.
May katuturan nito sapagkat ano ba ang imahe ng Pilipinas ngayon? Nagdesisyon ng Court Suprema in favor of the Marcoses. Ito ba ay isang expected decision? Noong 1986, wala pa yung ilang mga reporters natin sa mundo, hinirang at kinilala at hinangaan ng Pilipinas sa pamamagitan ng people power. Napatalsik ang diktador, napunta sa Hawaii, akala sa Pawai. Namaya pa noong 1989, naiuwi noong 1993. At ako po yung isa sa mga nag-cover noong pagdating ng kanyang labi sa Ilocos Norte. Hindi lamang sa kahalagahan ng pangyayari, I just wanted to see Ilocos how it was during the time. So history na yon, nagkaroon ng desisyon kahapon, papayagan ng mailibing sa libingan ng mga bayani. Ano kaya ang imahe ng Pilipinas sa daigdig ngayon? Sapagkat kung noong 1986, inalipos tayong diktadura ni Marcos, ngayon parang kinikilala ng bayani. I'd like to introduce our guests this morning, si Professor Aileen Baviera ng UP Asian Center, narito sa atin, at kasama rin natin ang isang security defense consultant at isang historian, si Ginoong Jose Antonio Custodio. Darating po si dating Congressman Jose Apolinario Lozada and dating Commodore Rex Robles, na isa sa mga nagtatag ng Revolusyonaryong Alyansang Makabayan. Magandang umaga po, Professor Aileen Baviera, at ganun din kay Ginoong Custodio. Simulan natin ang ating talakayan. Siguro dun muna tayo sa impact ng mga pagdalaw ng presidente sa ASEAN at sa China at sa Japan.
Mahalaga na unang dalawin ng presidente, yung mga kapitbahay natin, dahil ito yung pinaka-intensive yung relasyon natin siguro in terms of trade, people-to-people relations, labor migration, and so on. No? So tama lang na unahin ng presidente yung pagdalaw sa China, sa Japan, tsaka sa ilang bansa ng ASEAN. No? Yung sa China, kasi ang pinakamahalagang problema ng China siguro sa foreign relation ng Pilipinas sa foreign relations ay yung disputes natin sa China at yung naging abnormal na state ng relasyon natin itong mga nakaraang taon, no? So yung pagsasaayos ng relasyon na yon talaga mataas sa agenda dapat ng bagong gobyerno. Tapos yung sa Japan, ganun din, no? Malaki yung papel ng Japan sa both sa economic tsaka sa security situation natin, no? ASEAN naman, bilang tayo ang chair ng ASEAN at sa susunod na taon, marami tayong mga activities na pangungunahan, kung ano yung magiging direksyon ng ASEAN, ano yung mga tutunguhin nito. So tama naman yung choices na ito yung mga dadalawin.
Opo. Pero naging tradisyon kasi ng mga dating pangulo, nung sila ay nanungkulan, ang unang dinadalaw ay Estados Unidos. Parang nagbibigay galang sa patron. Tama nga ba yung ganong interpretasyon?
Matagal nang hindi. Actually, yung kung ilang pangulo na yung nakaraan, ASEAN country, no? Ang pinupuntahan. No? May karanasan pa nga ang mga dating gobyerno natin na nahihirapan sila kumuha ng invitasyon na dumalaw sa US. No? So, ano rin, patunay din yun kung gaano hindi na mataas ang posisyon ng Pilipinas sa hierarchy siguro ng mga relasyon ng US din. No?
Sa tingin po ba ngayon, sa tingin ninyo ngayon, ano yung prioridad ng Estados Unidos na mga bansa maliban sa Pilipinas?
Mm-hmm. Marami, kung tutusin, no? Dahil global power yan. Ang major concerns ng US, nandun pa rin sa Europa, yung ginagawa ng Russia, halimbawa, no? Sa Middle East, yung problema sa Syria, problema ng Islamic State, no? Ito yung mga mas malalaki na security concerns nila, no? Sa labas ng Asia, no? Sa Asia naman, relatively, ang tingin eh, relatively stable yung sitwasyon. Siyempre, merong pag-aalinlangan tungkol sa China, no? Ano yung role ng China, yung bang impluensya ng China eh masyado nang lumalakas dito sa lalo na sa East Asia, at ano yung magiging impact nito sa mga interest ng Estados Unidos.
Napakagandang insights niyan. Mr. Custodio, bilang isang security and defense consultant at historian sa larangan ng militar, significant po ba yung pagdalaw sa China at sa Japan? Bakit hindi inuna yung Japan? Bakit nauna yung China at yung mga bansa sa Asia?
Well, I'm not privy to why these two countries, which I mean to say, not privy to why was one before the other, okay? But what I'm just going to comment about is the messaging, basically, which has tend to be enacted into a policy by the national security sector in the Philippines, no? Because during the China visit, there were a number of statements that were provocative in nature. And then when you had the Japanese visit the following week, you had a set of contrary statements emanating from the president also. So traditionally, we have considered that presidential statements are the basis of policy of an administration. Okay, so previously that has been the arrangement. So now, how does the administration handle all of these statements? How will it merge them into a coherent national security policy? For in one end, in China, you say that we are aligned ourselves with China and Russia and the Philippines against the world. And then when in Japan, there is no alliance with China. So therefore, I would not envy Esperon in this matter, because he will have his hands full trying to craft a national security policy. At the same time, there is also the presence of the United States as our military ally, okay? That there is still no coherent policy also in how are we going to handle the future military-to-military relations between the countries, between the two countries, okay? By today's November, December, by first quarter next year, you will have the Balikatan exercises, okay? How will this be established, okay? Much of the exercises, a portion of the exercises between the Philippines and the United States were aligned on giving the Philippines exposure to concepts on territorial defense. Okay, now if you scrap that, then what then are the exercises going to do in terms of benefiting the combat effectiveness of the AFP as it transitions from internal to external? Or are we going the way of Costa Rica, you know, which basically has no concept of external defense? No? So those are the things that the National Security Council or the National Security Advisor has to sit down together with the Defense Secretary, the Foreign Affairs Secretary, and, you know, come up with a national security strategy. No? Because we do have a national security policy, which was done during the time of President Aquino. But the recent pronouncements and declarations of the current administration seems to different from what the original NSP of 2011 to 2016 envisioned. Uh-huh. So now it is high time that the administration, this new one, or not relatively new because it's 4 months, no, it needs to craft a national security policy and then from there come up with a national security strategy so that we can make sense of what has happened in the past weeks and what is going to happen also vis-a-vis our relations with ASEAN.
Okay. Had you been in the shoes of General Esperon, anong nakikita mong magandang gawin?
Ay, naman ba, Jessica? Ano to? Seriously speaking, what I will do basically is that I will, I will advise the president for a defense cluster meeting, okay, with the foreign security, foreign affairs, etc. Sit down and okay, let's plot what's going to, because everything has implications, okay. Everything that you do right now has implications beyond the administration itself, the lifespan of the administration, okay. Whatever we do right now, it either affects the next generation of the Filipinos, it affects the Philippines in the long run. So you really have to craft a strategy regarding this. No? So I will advise that a strategy has to be crafted sooner rather than later.
All right. Thank you. Professor, what do you have to say about the inconsistencies or the changing statements of the president? Coming from the academe, would this in a way help people craft foreign policy and defense strategies?
Absolutely not, no. Kasi nga, we are, this government is starting off with situations that require clarity, that require a strategic positioning and guidance to people in government, to the bureaucracy, to the people, to the public, no. So hindi pwedeng mixed signals, hindi pwedeng statement ngayon, bukas bawi, tapos kanya-kanyang interpretasyon, no? It's understandable that there will be a period of adjustment habang tinatantya mo yung situation. At the same time, yung interactions mo sa ibang bansa, tinitingnan mo rin how they will be responding, no? But the actual crafting of policy has to be done, of course, behind the scenes, not in the public limelight. No? Ngayon, kung nauuna yung statements dun sa policy, tapos magkakabawian, lahat nalilito, gobyerno, yung publiko, yung mga partner na bansa, international community, media. Tapos yung iba naman na tagalabas, hindi nila nakikita masyado yung konteksto nung mga statements. So, yung mga interpretasyon nila, minsan lalong nakakalala, lalong nakakadagdag ng confusion. No? So, clarity is always good. Kung hindi pa klaro mismo yung policy, then one has to exercise discretion, no? To provide guidance kung hanggang saan na merong malinaw na policy, kung ano pa yung kakulangan, then kung ano pa yung mga gaps, then kailangan magtrabaho ng seryoso behind the scenes.
No? Yes, please.
State visits, basically, yeah, through history, state visits have always been a way for a country, a host country, to size up the leader of the visiting country. Okay, so China did that when our president went there. They sized him up. Okay, so this is what he's saying. Okay, evaluate it. Okay, so right now it's churning in the national security corridors of China, all of these statements, especially following the visit to Japan. The Japanese government is now also going to evaluate the statements. Okay, and then they're going to, so a clarity of policy is very much required, because if foreign countries see that you don't have clarity of policy, then it will even affect the relations to us, and might what we have right now, whatever pledges or agreements that we have right now, may not be pursued in the future, or they will not be as enthusiastic if they don't see clarity.
So it is more to our disadvantage if the president would continue to open his mouth.
Who's going to answer that?
No, you know.
Well, like I said,
depends on what he says.
Yeah, there you go. It depends on what he says, and it also depends on the fact of the ability of the cabinet to present it as part of a strategy itself. No, but like I said, it really depends.
Yeah, the reason I ask is during the time of President Aquino, a Chinese diplomat and I had lunch, and we focused on what was going on, and he said, "Have you seen Mr. Xi Jinping talk about the South China Sea? It's only the spokesman of the foreign ministry, if not the foreign affairs minister, and Xi Jinping has remained quiet." Now, in the Philippines, it's your president doing the talking instead of DFA and the spokesman. So there is no elbow room for Mr. Aquino to maneuver.
Well, The thing is that even in the Philippine government, they are recreating the way that policy is being done by virtue of the statements also of our cabinet secretaries of trying to downplay or spin the statements that have been said. So the new paradigm right now is that presidential statements do not necessarily mean policy. Wait for the cabinet to clarify everything. That's the new mantra. So that, of course, it's very difficult for them to undertake that thing. Okay, much more desirable is that you have clarity in terms of the entire administration and its focus to such things. And you have people like Andanar or Abelia, you know, being the ones. Or I think during the time of the previous administration, the messaging was very controlled. You had Charles Jose, right? And before him, he was this
still
other
is.
Guy.
Raul
Hernandez and Charles Jose being the people providing the statements. And there was a memo, I think, for that, right? That they were supposed to be the only ones. And then, especially in South China Sea, West Philippine Sea issues. So you don't have the situation wherein you have, and where you have too many voices speaking, because they already realized early on that too many voices speaking would result in problems.
Yeah, I remember during the time of the Scarborough Shoal in 2012, I asked the Northern Luzon Command Chief, Lieutenant General Anthony Alcantara, and he gave me some information, although the next time I talked to him, he said, you have to talk to the guys at DFA because I'm not allowed to speak anymore, although the Scarborough Shoal is within my jurisdiction. So you'd rather have it that way.
Great that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Well, I think if the president says something, then it should be understood as policy, not personal sentiments. No? So if the president says, it has to have really some weight already. No? So it's
like
important.
Like God talking to him on the plane.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. On the other hand, if you say that Xi Jinping doesn't address this issue, it also shows the relative importance that they attach to it. No? For the Philippines, the West Philippine Sea issue, it's very important. It's high on the priority of government. That's why the president can talk about this. No? So China, they don't want to give this issue importance, so it will not be the president to talk about it. It will be some underling.
Okay, so that's the reason for this.
That's also one reason.
Okay, and it also insulates the chief executive from having no room to maneuver.
Yes, because the buck stops with him, no? As with our president.
Yeah. Pero katulad po nito ngayon, merong binanggit itong si outgoing President Obama na pivot to Asia. Do you think this will still happen when you have President Clinton or President Trump at the White House?
Yung pivot to Asia, it's been several years since this was announced. No? At may problema talaga sa implementation. No? First of all, the U.S. may not have the resources to finance a really substantive pivot. No? Kasi ang ibig sabihin yan, yung ang commitment nila was 60%, halimbawa of their ships will be based here. Yung ganun, eh, merong military dimension, strongest ang military dimension niya na hindi na necessarily kayang tuparin ng U.S. without the support of its allies mismo. No? So much of the burden mapupunta sa allies. So problematic na siya to begin with. No? Even if the U.S. Campaign is any indication ng sentiment ng American people, kung sino man ang manalo, baka magka-problema pa rin sa implementation yan.
Yes, please.
The pivot to Asia is not exactly a how would I say this? It is the current permutation, if I use the term, no, of something that the U.S. had wanted to do since the 1990s. There was an earlier attempt to have a pivot to Asia. Okay, during the 1990s, you had the Quadrennial Defense Review in the late 1990s. One of the Quadrennial Defense Reviews stated a rising regional hegemon. Okay, that would be one of America's concerns in the Pacific area. And of course, that naturally meant China. And the Philippines became part of that, became crucial to that because of the multilateral approach that the Americans wanted to introduce here to the Philippines, into the region. And the multilateral approach was a way to get partners, okay, like Australia, the Philippines, to work in tandem. Sometimes I think they also wanted to invite China in non-lethal, non-combat system exercises. Like I remember then you had SAGIP.
Yeah, humanitarian.
Yes, yes, SAGIP.
Programs.
But the intent of that really was to set up a regional framework, which was to contain China. That was the basic, and that was before. That was in the 1990s. And that's why we had the VFA, you had all of those things coming in. That was the framework to contain a rising regional, but something got in the way. And you see, that's the thing with the United States, that sometimes conditions are changed by certain developments. And the thing that got in the way, which interrupted this earlier attempt to pivot to Asia, was the 9/11 attacks. So when the 9/11 attacks, the focus of the United States suddenly became counterterrorism. Okay, so that's why BK-02-01, if I remember correctly, BK-02-01, which was Balikatan 02-01, transformed into a United States participation in attempts to, by the Philippine government, to quell the Abu Sayyaf.
Okay.
So there. So that's what I'm talking about. So that adds to the problems of the United States, okay? You have certain things that just pop into the strategic environment that you have to deal with.
Okay.
And that being said, from 2001 up to 2010, thereabouts, okay, you had that frame of mind, the war on terrorism. So it was quite long, okay?
Yes.
And made things worse was that was it 2007, the crisis?
2008.
The, uh-huh. The U.S. economic crisis. So that
yes.
also sort of...
Lehman and something?
And then, you know, the economic crisis was such that it affected American capabilities to not just project power, but to undertake certain military-to-military activities that they had. So, this all changed a few years ago. Okay, so you had again this announcement of pivot to Asia and so on and so forth. But still, the fundamental thing remains, which is to establish a multilateral, a regional framework of partners and allies. Okay?
Okay,
so they're still trying to do that. And in this case, the two top contenders that will ease the American burden is Japan. Okay.
All right.
Which itself has its own peculiar relationship with Japan, with China, and of course Australia, as in the southern. But of course, there's one country for whatever national interest it has wants to play around in this region is also India. Okay. So they're trying to build. It's still there. Okay. So now that the Philippines has decided to do this, what will be the American reactions to this? Okay. I am not of the opinion that this will really destroy America's position in it, because there's so much strategic maneuvering space in the Central Pacific to
yes.
to South China Sea area. There's so much. It is not. You still have Guam. You still have
Wake Island.
You still have Vietnam itself.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So there. So yeah. And then what I've noticed is that there is a rising perception in the U.S. right now among some talking heads that perhaps it's time to review the military alliance system of the U.S.
Okay. Now, what is it that they have in Japan which is different from those from Okinawa? The Okinawans hate the Americans. They want to boot them out of their place. Yet, Japan relies on the United States as its strategic partner. Coming from the UP Asian Center, how do you look at this?
Yeah, well, the people of Okinawa feel that they are being made to bear the entire burden of the alliance relationship, no? Because it's on a day-to-day basis. They suffer the noise, they have to deal with, you know, misbehavior ng mga US troops. So it's natural that they resent this, no? They also, many of them also feel that US presence creates more triggers for conflict rather than solves, no? But the way many people feel when you have bases, no, in their areas.
Yes. No?
We used to be in that situation. But Japan, of course, the country itself faces many threats, not least from China was mentioned, but also North Korea, di ba? So nuclearization of Korean Peninsula. Russia-Japan relations are still difficult. They have territorial disputes. So on the whole, and China's relations with most of its neighbors, Korea, China, Taiwan, ganon, have still not overcome the historical burdens, di ba? Yung occupation of the World War, ganon. So maraming hostile talaga against Japan, no? So in that kind of situation, then Japan feels that it needs some help.
Yeah. Quote, unquote.
Yeah, to secure its own security environment.
Yeah. Would you care to add to the discussion about the difference between Okinawans and the Japanese?
Oh, I'm cool with I'm cool with what you said.
Okay, but historically, what is it that Japan has with the United States?
Well,
that it loves to hate China?
Oh, no, it's more like what Japan has with China, actually, because it's, like I said, it's a peculiar relationship that predates everything. It's something that has gone on for the centuries, okay? It's a tit for tat thing, okay? You have the Mongol invasion, you have Japan's invasion of Korea, you have, and I'm talking about Japan's adventure in Korea during the pre-shogunate period, okay? Then you had Japan cutting itself off from the world, then the Americans coming in, then the Japan having the Meiji period, and then, you know, establishing again its foothold in mainland Asia. And the tit for tat continues. So, and you had the Sino-Japanese War of 1895. For a historian, I'm really lousy in dates. I think it was because of yesterday. I don't know.
Don't worry, I'll be asking you about
no,
that.
No, don't answer me. I will need to drink beer more again. So the thing is that you have. Japan's desire to, you know, protect itself from Western colonialism, using that as a justification to launch an imperial adventure of its own beginning in the 19th century. And like I said, all of this predated this US relationship with Japan. So Japan has its own strategic reasons, okay, born out by its own history, not just to China, but also its experience in the Second World War. One thing that the Japanese military had taken to heart was the fact that at the end of the Pacific War, the Japanese homeland was practically cut off from the rest of the world by the might of the United States Navy. And United States Army Air Forces were bombing Japan on a 24/7 basis. So Japan was cut off, and we all know that Japan's weakness is resources that it needs from outside. So issues of logistics, issues of sea control, those are very important for the Japanese.
Okay.
And China then is interpreted by some Japanese defense analysts as excuse the term that they use, but they say it's like a dog that's going around their neighborhood, their house, and peeing everywhere.
Uh-huh.
So in a way, marking territory. So if you put that within the context of Japan's World War II experience, okay, wherein the American naval blockade, or even in the beginning, okay, when the Americans embargoed Japan because of its China adventure in 1940,
yes.
This triggered the Look South movement of the Japanese military, which is why they attacked Southeast Asia, because all the resources were coming from here.
Okay.
Now, in the Philippines was that wonderful thing in the center that protected all the sea lanes. Okay. But again, what I'm talking about here is sea lanes protecting Japan's contact to the outside world. So I think that manifests itself. That's why even in the Cold War, one of Japan's military missions was to do anti-submarine warfare.
Okay.
kay preventing blockades.
Okay, very well. Now, considering all this, do you think the Americans will leave Okinawa and settle somewhere else? Because we still have the EDCA, which is, I would say, some people say is worse than the VFA. So will they really come to stay in the Philippines under EDCA, which President Duterte said something about some time ago?
Well, I think there are similarities between Japan and the Philippines, no? But of course, Okinawa is a full-blown base, and we have a constitution that prohibits permanent military bases. And a, of course, stakeholders in the Philippines or a segment of the public that is strongly opposed, no, to the return of bases. So magkaiba na yon. But there's, of course, a dynamic relationship. The less cooperative the Philippines will be in terms of supporting U.S. military strategy, then the greater the burden for Japan. And this is why Japan is also concerned about recent statements. So the president has said that EDCA will continue to be implemented. Now, under what conditions, in response to what external, you know, stimuli, all of that is really up in the open. No? The other thing, again, relating to the role of Japan, no? The U.S. is there to guarantee Japan's security. If U.S. was not, then the options for Japan would be to militarize, to take care of its own security. Uh-huh. And that may mean a great, stronger military role in our own region. And the U.S. used to justify the alliance with Japan, saying, you know, it's better that we take care of Japan rather than Japan will take care of itself and, you know, invade na naman, maging aggressive towards its neighbors. And that used to be an accepted argument. But now even the U.S. sees that it cannot guarantee security in the region. And it is pushing Japan more in the direction of playing an active security role. So whatever U.S. policy will be in the future regarding the pivot, I think we can expect Japan to pursue stronger security ties with the Philippines, with other like-minded countries. So it's going to be a new Japan that we will be looking at.
Really? Yes.
To support also Ma'am Baviera's statements here is that this also did not happen overnight with the cards of Japan, okay? If you look at Japanese weapon systems, okay, and activities, as early as 1989, they were already considering the problems in the post-Cold War scenario. And one of the peculiar things that they did was that they introduced, sometimes in the early 1990s, they introduced a ship that was known as, that it's still operational now, a ship class known as the Osumi class. So what's so peculiar about the Osumi? If you see it, it has a flat deck. Uh-huh. It's a flat deck. It's a flat top, okay? But it's a small flat top. So they're saying, oh no, it's just an amphibious vessel and so on and so forth. But then a decade later, they introduced another class of ship, slightly larger now. It was the Hyuga class. Now, the Hyuga class, you had the Hyuga and the Ise. And they were practically, they looked like aircraft carriers already because they were flat up through deck, okay? Uh-huh. They were as big, they were slightly bigger or as big as the British Invincible class carriers. And one, the Ise, was here in Yolanda, in the relief operations of Yolanda. It was here. And then it returned early this year, in April, it paid a port call in all of places, Subic. Why? Out of the way, United. But it's not Subic. I think the media was invited to look at it. But but did they stop there? No. Last year, they introduced another ship, which was another class, which is the Izumo class, larger than the Ise, which is already as large, the Izumo is as large as an American fleet carrier of World War II. Then these ships, they can reconvert to operate vertical takeoff and landing aircraft, carrier-type aircraft. They can do that, okay? And knowing Japanese capabilities, it will not be difficult for them to do that in the near future. And ships like this have a lifespan of 30 to 40 years, okay? That being said, you could see that Japan was priming itself for such a responsibility in the U.S. American defense, the U.S. Japan defense framework.
Yeah, very well. But having said that, Professor Baviera, that Mr. Duterte is in a way, you know, undecided about what to do with EDCA, will it not endanger his position as president? Because Mr. Duterte was quoted saying some time ago that he feels he may not be able to finish his term.
Well, that's a tough question. There are, I guess, a number of reasons that he may not be able to finish his term. But his talking about it is not very assuring to the people. No? I suppose when people voted for him, those who did vote wanted him to fulfill a six-year term, no? For stability. No? But that said, will it endanger him politically if he, again...
Besides to leave the American side?
To leave the American side. You're talking about, I guess, the strong public opinion in favor of U.S. relations and so on. No? I mean, what can the people do? You already elected him into office. No? Are you talking about, again, extra legal attempts to unseat a president? We don't know. You know, it's dangerous talk. A lot of it is going around. Yeah, a lot of speculation is going around. But there are, I guess, I can imagine a lot of other people with motives to want the president out relating to domestic politics, the drug war, and so on. That is probably a bigger risk than any foreign policy interventions, for instance. Mm.
All right. We'll open the floor to our colleagues from the media who may have questions this morning. Let's start, ladies first, with Maki Pulido. Yes, Maki. May mikropono yata tayo rito. Sandali po.
Para po sa dalawa na nasa panel, ano lang po dahil nga election ngayon sa Amerika, why should we care as Filipinos? Ano ba yung impact sa atin yan? If it's a Clinton win or if it's a Trump win, tapos does it really matter who wins? Sa kung Pilipinas po in the Philippine interest context.
Kaya mo yun.
Ladies first. Then I'll get after you.
No, well, basically, yes, it matters. No? It matters not just to the Philippines. It matters to a whole lot of other countries. No? One is a Trump presidency will introduce a lot of unpredictability dun sa policy ng US in many regions of the world, including East Asia, including alliances, and including with the Philippines. No? Clinton has been is a known factor. Her policy preferences are clear. She was one of the, of course, the main, you could say, the people behind the U.S. rebalance policy. She has clearer views on China, and some consider her a hawk, no? Rather than a dove, so you might expect a stronger emphasis on alliance and security relationships and resistance to China. But surprisingly, even if you ask the Chinese, many of them even prefer Clinton to Trump, despite her being a hawk, because she is predictable, because she is a known figure. And therefore, if you know what you're dealing with, then you can proceed accordingly. If you don't know what you're dealing with, then that creates more stresses and challenges for foreign policy decision making. No? Now, it's the same for us. No? Right now, frankly, our own government is a bit unpredictable with our foreign policy. There are already challenges to the alliance system. So those who would like the alliance to stay are already concerned. No? So Duterte plus Trump would be even more yes. Yeah. So it's going to be a different world.
Will it be more interesting?
more interesting, but you know
in
how
the Chinese parlance?
In the Chinese parlance, where they say it's
more
curse.
Of a curse than a blessing.
Yeah, the Chinese curse is may you live in interesting times. No? So we may be facing that no? with a Trump presidency. Clinton presidency will be, no, I think would be also interesting because the world really has changed. No, Brexit, so many things are really different from the world as we had known it no? in the past generation.
Tumitingin sa akin.
Yes, please.
Tumingin na sa akin. Patay. No, the thing is that the
past generation.
Oh, yeah. The thing is that God, I need a beer. The thing is that
you'll have it.
Thank you. Praise Jesus. The thing is that the reason why we are so interested in the elections is that we're trying to figure out what will be the direction of Philippine-U.S. relations in either administration. But what we have to consider is the fact that the relations are bad right now, okay? It's, you know, not in a very nice place right now, the relations that we have in the United States. So the actions have already, in the U.S. side, the actions seem to have spread from the executive already to the legislative. You have the U.S. Senate. If the Reuters report is true, yeah, you have the U.S. Senate allegedly blocking firearm sales to the Philippines. Okay, if that report is true, but that is an indicator that it has spread. Okay, so relations between the two countries have, if they are to be repaired, they have to handle certain issues that both sides don't seem to, at this point in time, don't seem to want to reconcile with. Okay. We do remember Obama's statement following the or during the ASEAN meeting that he said that the Philippines can be a partner if you follow international norms and practices, if I'm correct. So that's the U.S. perspective, okay? And as long as the U.S. sees that we are not there, then that will, regardless of the administration, then that will become an issue, okay? Because you're dealing now with the U.S. bureaucracy. The U.S. bureaucracy, it's not the president, it's the U.S. bureaucracy and the U.S. branches of government already. So that's why whoever our ambassador in the U.S. is going to be will have his hands full trying to fix things, okay? Or trying to find ways to handle things, especially when it comes to the U.S. Senate or the Congress, because that's where I think there's a new front developing.
Thank you. Follow up.
Wala na.
Sige, may follow-up daw.
Who could be, kasi mamaya-maya lang, alam na natin kung sino. Pero, who do you think is better for the Philippines? Tapos, of course, there's this, ano na, kahit sino naman ang umupo dyan, doesn't really matter to us. U.S. foreign policy is U.S. foreign policy. And how it deals with other countries. May ganun din na akong nadiligin. So, kung halimbawa, kung sino sa kanila, who could be better
president
in the Philippine context, U.S. president in the Philippine context?
Ma? Yun, kayo na, sir. We'd like to acknowledge, narito na si dating Congressman Jose Apolinario Lozada, si dating ring ambassador ng Pilipinas sa Palau, at narito rin si Commodore Rex Robles, isa sa nagtatag ng RAM. So, ano kaya ang pananaw ninyo? Maganda yung tanong ni Mac.
Good morning.
I'm surprised for being late.
Nabigla ako doon. Anyway, if we had to be very professional about it, none of the above eh. Kung si Trump ang mananalo, eh medyo mahihirapan tayo sa pagninegosyo sa Amerika because he would like to concentrate more on the domestic market ng Amerika. So, medyo mahirap. Kung si Hillary naman, eh medyo iba rin yung concentration niya eh. She's really more on security aspects rather than domestic aspect. And with our present governance, ang gobyerno natin ngayon na medyo hindi natin alam kung ano talagang direction ng ating foreign policy, medyo mahihirapan tayo. That's correct, I agree. We should really have a very good American ambassador in the U.S. his hands will be full, but he should really also be able to play all the aspects of ang sabihin natin revolutionary diplomatic approaches na mag-fit dito sa thinking and the character of our president. So for me, choosing between the two, siguro Hillary would be a better one for us. But if you have to be very professional about it, it's really none of the above. Eh.
Wala silang smartmatic doon, no, sa America?
Wala. When I left the office, I was informed that it seems to be a Hillary presidency already. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. You think it's not a hilarious victory, no?
Depends on how we play it.
Yeah.
As a player, it can be really hilarious with the way we conduct our own foreign policy.
Okay, Commodore Robles, your thoughts about this, because you were once with the Department of National Defense and you dealt with Americans during your time when Secretary Enrile was Secretary of Defense. Do you think the
presidency ito, no?
Yeah.
It's a toss up, parang gamble eh. Karay Cruz, ganun. Iba pag Karay Cruz, sasaluin mo nang ganun.
Yeah.
Pag salo mo nang ganun Trump, pag ganun mo Hillary. So, we don't know. I would stick to someone whom we know, and I would be familiar with how bad Hillary can be. I would be familiar. But Trump, he is a loose cannon even to himself. So we don't know what he will do. But Hillary, I know to what group he has, yung neo-colonial group niya, at saka yung kanilang acquisitiveness. Alam ko na yun eh.
Uh-huh. And parang actually, may mining industry, ganun.
Hindi, kasi mababalance na natin kasi nauna na si Presidente magbalance noon eh. So hindi na tayo masyadong mag-isip pa kung ano saan tayo pupunta. Kay Trump, we have to rethink everything. We don't know eh. Hindi natin alam eh. Saka, alam mo na, there are so many long arguments. Pero yun na nga, pag toss coin mo, Trump, pag inanon mo, Hillary. Kasi kanina, 9:30, 68, 66, nag-catch up siya eh. Nag-stop si Hillary to 68, nag-catch up naman siya from 48 to 66. So dalawang college. Oo, 9:30 yon. Kasi nasabi, punta ako sa Visayas eh.
Ngayon, nasa Mindanao ka na. Okay. Meron pang follow-up, Madam Maki? Yeah. Wala na. Okay. Pero...
Opinion lang.
You'll have your beer, courtesy of Jun Lozada.
I don't know. I'm just having problems with somebody who can't kill that thing on his head. The thing which passes off as hair. That's all I can say. You know? It's like that hair. It's a statement.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
But that being said, if Clinton wins, the administration has to take into consideration that this is a seasoned veteran of international affairs, okay, and politics, and including certain actions that have led to regime changes, okay, like in Libya, like in or really aggressive actions, okay, like in the Pakistan, wherein they took out Obama. Oh, sorry, Osama. Not Obama.
Osama. Bin Laden.
Bin Laden. Obama Bin Laden. That's why I didn't want to answer. That's why I didn't want to answer.
All right, all right. Okay.
And that means for us with the Duterte presidency, Prof.
Oh, Prof na naman. Oh, yes.
What does that mean? Because with that kind of a Clinton
very expertise. Focused siya. Focused. Whereas...
So tayo, papayagin ba niya tayo mawala?
Well, not really.
Not
not in the 1960s.
With this kind of Philippine presence.
There will always be repercussions, more serious. But like I said, even in the U.S. side, okay, there are reevaluations of the value of a military alliance that, and you see that in talking heads already that are coming out much more frequently in the past few weeks alone. So, like I said, whether or not, if it's Clinton or Trump, there will already be repercussions because of the fact that there's a lot of reassessment in the U.S. side now regarding their relations with the Philippines. And like I said, I'm using that as a gauge is a comments now on reevaluating the mutual defense treaty, if it is really beneficial to American interests or not.
Yeah. Now, speaking of the mutual defense treaty, how do you look at it? Is still there a need for that?
I don't know if I'm bragging, but I don't have to look at it because we faced the Americans, remember, twice sa negotiations. Talagang maliwanag na maliwanag na they're just out to take advantage of us. During the negotiations, talagang mga walang hiya talaga. Smooth sila, decente sila, pero... They just look out for their interests. Ngayon, there is a provision, Article 2. Both parties are bound to enhance each other's capability to resist armed aggression. And it behooves on the United States as a stronger ally to strengthen our capacity and not us to strengthen their capacity. But what have they done so far? If you go to Mindanao, you go to Zamboanga, nandito yung US facilities, spanking white SUVs, about a dozen of them in line white, and then ang mga buildings nila magaganda. And right next to it are the Air Force barracks that are really run down. And why we allowed it, and I have been calling attention to it for a long time, is yung mga Amerikano mismo happy sila eh. Namukha silang sikat eh. Samantalang tayo, why do we allow Americans to build their own facilities here and look good and make, and just be blasé about how we look like.
You know, I heard from a general that he couldn't just enter the enclave of the Americans without the go signal.
No,
from a colonel.
No, in the supply station doon, yung supply point, they have sandbags na nakabalot ng mabuti yung sandbags nila. Hindi yung sandbags natin. Ha? Malinis yun. Ang laman noon, malinis. You cannot just cross into it. Yeah. Without asking permission, but they go in and out of our facilities. Kaya yung kasalanan natin eh. Mukha tayong mga tanga eh. Ganun.
Exactly.
Natanga-tanga tayo eh.
Okay. Now, coming from an academician, how do you look at this? Is there a way out from this kind of treatment that we have from the Americans?
Yeah, I mean, tama yun. Kasalanan natin. We allowed ourselves to be treated like a doormat. No? So the change that we need is in our behavior, in our mindset, in how we deal with the Americans. No? So yung independent foreign policy, it's not about getting the U.S. out. It's getting ourselves to be more assertive in the relationship with the U.S. No? I think yung question mo on the MDT, do we still need the MDT, no? If we could be even 75% sure that there is no threat to the Philippines, especially external threat, no? That China will behave well, that other powers will not try to take advantage of the neighbor or even some of our neighbors, no? Then maybe you could say we don't need MDT, no? So if we can successfully negotiate with China, for instance, I don't know how long it's going to take, no? To establish that kind of relationship that China is no longer a threat, then maybe that's the way to get rid of the MDT if you are so unhappy with it, no? But an overnight decision, maybe we should be more careful, no? Because we don't know. No? We don't know yet. We haven't really gone to that point where we can say there is no external threat.
Yes, please.
I think a problem also in many of our experiences with Americans is that it also stems from our failings, okay, in expressing what really are our national interests, okay? Frequently manifests itself in bilateral meetings with the United States, when the Americans come with all of this, bang, they set it down. And the Philippine side just grapples with everything, okay? And then sometimes there's always the situation wherein, because there's a difficulty in consistently focusing on a plan that when you have a change of personnel, it's like starting all over again. Okay, so I think that's usually what the problems that we have here. That's why, for example, the Americans can do that. And it's not just Americans, because if you have that set, that mindset or that way that we approach things, that, for example, from the very highest, we don't really have a concept of what our national security objectives are. And then all the way down to a difficulty in even figuring out what is the nature of the relationship or the advantages or disadvantages of having the mission Americans, then I believe that whoever you deal with, talampasuhin tayo, regardless of if it's Japan, Australia, it's India, or even China. Okay?
Yes, madam.
Just one line. But we need to build our own capability. Yes, that's yes. The thing, di ba? More self-reliance sa security natin. To the extent possible, diversify our security partnerships. As
really? But if we have hand-me-down ships from the United States, these ships are older than the captains, you know, running the ship. Older than Commodore Robles. Yes, please.
My greatest fear really is in the Hillary Clinton administration is that you know, she's the author of the American Pivot to Asia. And she's really more concerned of security. And her statement says that the security of the United States of America depends greatly on the way America is going to take care of its allies. And they're not going to take, I think they're not going to just loosen up their grip on the Philippines, which is really in the middle of the U.S.-China rivalry. I'm afraid that we should really have to prepare ourselves well. And taking from Aileen's statement here that we have to change, I think that we really need, I agree, we have to change, but I couldn't see in the horizon a set of Filipino diplomats or negotiators who fit into the description of having changed their attitude towards the United States of America. I know that the change should really come from us now, not really from the United States of America. We have to be really more aggressive in dealing with them.
Uh-huh.
If they are going to be aggressive to us, we should really also be aggressive to them. But are our diplomats ready for this?
I heard Mr. Luxin will be appointed Philippine ambassador to
But there's also a problem there because Mr. Luxin has the necessary educational background, but he has never had any experience in diplomacy. And we really have to play our roles very well here. We should really show to them that we know our rights, that we can insist on our own visions and what we really want.
Okay.
Without just following their dictates or whatever they would like to get from us.
Okay. Yes, Commodore.
Yeah.
We may have also a series of questions from ABS-CBN. Yes, please.
May I follow up on your points? Kasi the first is about being assertive. During our negotiations, and we did that twice, ang mga Amerikano kasi, they will learn to respect you if you assert yourself. Eh. To the point na pagdating namin sa negotiating table, gumaganon na sila. Eh. Here they are again. Gaganon sila. Kasi takot sila because when we say, that's it. They have to go to the president to get what they want. And one time when they did that and tried to overturn us, all of us resigned, including Daniel Romualdez. And President Marcos had to frantically sign a reaffirmation of our appointments. So the Americans will recognize people who respect themselves. You have to show that you respect yourself. And the other point is, there are big words attached to this, unilateralism and multilateralism. But what really happens is, the word is, how do you take care of your allies? For the longest time after the world, after 1945-46, the United States started to turn into policeman of the world, which was looked like a good idea, but now it's turning out to be really bad. And some observers advocate that there should be multilateralism, which means he should use his allies to manage the world. Doon pa rin siya, pero wag niyang sabihin na katulad nung farewell speech ni Obama na America is still the greatest. It's self-deceiving eh. They are not. They are no longer the greatest. So they have to realize that.
So they still believe in their own propaganda.
Ni kasi masarap masarap pakiramdam nila na sikat sila eh. Lalo na yung mga neocons, they want to perpetuate that para yung mga tao na kausap nila, titiklop na lang, di ba?
Okay.
Saka makakaplano sila ng sarili nila. But we have a new president. We have a president who has a new outlook. And he is actually what the Indians call walking a razor's edge.
Razor's edge.
Pag nagkamali siya ng apak, lugsugat siya. Pag nahulog siya kaliwat kanan, hulog din siya. But he is a risk taker because of his propensity to make quick decisions. So he will make quick decisions and it involves risk. Ganon siya. Yung bigla mo na lang kuminsan, kausap mo siya ngayon, pag punta niya rin sa kabila, iba na yung sinasabi niya, mabibigla ka eh. Pati yung mga close sa kanya, nabibigla eh. So, but he takes risk, he's intuitive, and so far, he has not been making big mistakes. May mga small errors now and then.
Okay. Yeah, understood. Yes.
I think I will approach this from a historian's point of view, okay? Why are we like this? Because I think the fundamental problem of the Philippines is that 70 years after independence in 1946, we are still in a process of consolidation as a nation state. That being said, you have a plethora of security concerns. You don't know what you're going to do. Like, for example, let's use the AAP modernization as an example. Okay, 1997, you had the AAP, 1995, AAP modernization, right? Then you had the 1997 financial crisis, then suddenly the Abubakar campaign, and then suddenly the AAP modernization tweaks into internal security operations, okay? So these are examples of a country that is undergoing so much internal consolidation that there is actually debate within the national security sector on which actually is the bigger threat, external, internal. In the internal, which is the bigger threat? Secessionism, CPPNP. So it's all of these things. And that can affect your capacity to relate in a larger framework. So I think that is why it's very important really to have a strategy, okay, to face these things, okay? That's what I'm looking at it from a historian's angle, because the future, if it is not handled properly, the future is that it can be bleak for us, okay, in the future. Because I remember the problem why the thing that's why we have problems in consolidating, because we are a colonial creation.
Uh-huh.
And being a colonial creation, which is not the result of your country's own dynamics, okay, or your own people's dynamics, then you're facing a situation where you always have a problem in any area which believes that it's not part of
it
the
may
whole.
Be bleak, but you don't see Filipinos taking the boats to Vietnam. As in 1975.
Maybe a boat to Cebu. Or maybe a boat to Davao, I don't know.
Yeah, okay, or to Davao. Yes, question?
I don't understand the first part. What is the first part of the question?
You separate militarily
from
with US
from the United States. I don't really know. I can only have a feel of it. And what he is trying to do, as far as I know, I don't know if I'm correct, is that he's trying to avoid a situation where the United States is given a casus belli or a reason to confront the Chinese militarily at the expense of the Philippines. Sige, mag-away kayo kasi away niyo to, pero huwag niyo kaming isama dito. And in order to avoid that, hindi ko kalabanin ng mga NSIC kasi pag nag-away kayo, ang unang bombay ng mga NSIC kami. Which is what happened in World War II. And you know the consequences of that. The Americans never acknowledged the reparations that they have to make with us. They gave European countries billions of dollars of aid at, listen to this, 50 years grace. 50 years grace for billions of dollars. Tayo, anong binigay sa atin? Tuwing hingi tayo, Belt Trade Act. May mga ganon. So, again, it's not the fault of the Americans. Eh. It's us. It's Del Rosario type of thinking. Yun ang nagpapatay sa atin.
Sinong Del Rosario sinasabi mo?
Very obvious kung sino.
Yeah, maraming Del Rosario.
Yung magaling magsalita, ano, akala mo, malumanay, pero poisonous ang mga words. Eh. Ako, nagaganon ako pag nagsalita siya. Eh. Na ano ako na, ganun ba tayo kababa? Well, mayaman siya dahil sa ginawa niya at yayaman pa rin siya. Pero hanggang doon lang siya.
Okay. Magkapaalam na si Professor Baviera, pero let's go domestic sandali. Ano? Nagdesisyon na po yung Court Suprema kahapon na ilibing si Makoy, si dating Presidente Marcos, libingan ng mga bayani. Noong 1986, tiningala ang Pilipinas sa pagpapatalsik sa isang diktador. Ngayon, ililibing na si libingan ng mga bayani. How do you look at it? Anong magiging larawan ng Pilipinas sa international community?
Well, ang unang problema doon, parang wala tayong pagpapahalaga sa kasaysayan tsaka sa mga lessons na makukuha natin from kasaysayan. Kasi yung sinasabi nga ni Jose na parang we are still in the process of nation building. How do we build a nation? It's by learning collectively from our mistakes, from our triumphs, achievements. So doon na bubuo yung sense of nationhood. So kung ang ibig sabihin itong pagpapalibing ay binabaliwala na natin yung pagkondena sa dictatorship, yung mga sinasabi natin na yung abuses ng nakaraan, pinapatawad na natin, then it opens the doors. No? Kung hindi tayo mag-agree as a nation na mali yun, ayaw natin yun, kinokondena natin yun, then it's possible to make the same mistakes in the future. May risk na ganun. No? So we don't grow. No? Okay. Basically, yun ang tingin ko. Ang magiging impact niya sa ibang bansa is they will see the Philippines as a country that doesn't know what it stands for, ano yung values niya, ano yung gusto niyang mangyari sa ano mismo, sa bayan.
Okay. May business reporter kasi tayo rito. Yung bang state visits sa iba't ibang lugar, meron bang business na papasok kaya sa Pilipinas?
Meron naman, no? But the state visits are useful. At the end of the day, it's still the domestic policy and the environment that will attract investment, climate, good infrastructure, ganon. So ang mas malaking bahagi niyan is the homework that you need to do here to attract them and to keep them here. No?
So you have to have infrastructure not leading to subdivisions.
Certainly
it's for
not
everyone.
If it's, yeah, tourism, agriculture.
Okay. So, sandali lang po. We'll pause for a break. Magkakaroon tayo ng ating picture taking. Tapos tuloy tayo doon sa ating talakayan. Okay? Sandali po. Sandali lang. Lumalalim ng lumalalim yung discussion. Eh. Pero on the domestic front, ang tanong, dati po kay Ambassador, isang military historian at isa sa nagtatag ng RAM, hanggang kailan mararamdaman yung Marcos sa lipunan ng Pilipino?
I will start. Siguro hanggang hindi natin palitan yung ating ugali. It will always be there. It will just keep on coming back. Because we do not give, hindi natin tinutukan yung ating mga problema. Pabago-bago yung ating desisyon.
What about the sense of history? Sabi nila, we don't have a sense of history.
Well, at the same time, we don't have the sense of history. What's happening now? I cannot understand why... siguro, wag na rin tayo mag-celebrate ng EDSA, no? Otherwise, ano may, nakakahiya na tayo eh. Ano ba? I mean, February 20-something, 5. Anong gagawin mo doon? Anong, samantala... 22 sa akin. From 22 to 25. Tayo na witness the history unfolded. What are we going to celebrate with what is happening today?
Okay, so wala na lang. Joe, we have ikaw naman. Ito yung mikropono.
Oldest ang sir, meron ako dito. The question is basically why. Well, how do I say this? Again, I will approach this from a historian's angle, basically meaning to say that as a product of a colonial past, we have had a political system which, although our country is
as we say, it's going capitalist, you know, you have capitalist modes of production and so on and so forth. But the fundamental, but many in the political system are very feudal in perspective and in nature, okay? And that being said, that explains why there are many problems, social justice problems in the Philippines that persist, okay? And when those things happen, you have a cycle. In any history, in historical experience of a country, if you are into that situation, you will have a cycle of the desire of people who get frustrated, and you have the strongman memory becoming strong again, and then interest groups take advantage of that, and so on and so forth. Okay, so. But as long as the feudal perspectives, when I say feudal, I'm not talking about modes of production here. I'm talking about a mindset. Okay, for example, you have a politician with a very nice abode or a mansion, and then behind him are barong-barongs. And you find that in so many areas around the Philippines. Okay, so, and I think that's the feudal nature that is that is a feudal mindset. Okay, and that makes a cycle in the Philippines, okay? But time is running out for us. There are internal and external pressures that affect the Philippines. Internal, we have the secessionist movement, we have other movements out there. Then external, we have a clash of, an impending clash, okay? Whether we like it or not, we are going to be involved in that impending clash, maybe in a generation or two generations from now, okay? And that's why I said time is running out. The time to strengthen the country has to be done. But I think a fundamental way to do that is to, again, change the mindsets. That feudal mindset, okay, which you see. You go back through history, you just see it.
Okay.
Any politician. You know, what was in the 1960s? There was this guy who said, what are we in power for?
Yeah there was this lawmaker from Aspate who said that. Yes, Commodore.
Ako, sa specifics muna about the Marcos thing. I was wondering why the argument of Fidel Ramos that there was an agreement that the body could be brought back but buried in the Ilocos. Uh-huh. Yeah. But bakit hindi sinusunod yun at bakit hindi minention ng Supreme Court yun? Both sides never considered it. But I think to me that is one of the stronger arguments that you stop insisting and burying Marcos in the Libingan, and stop calling in your chips from Duterte because he cannot avoid it. Kayo mismo mga Marcoses, mahiya na kayo at ilibing nyo na yan kasi nilibing na rin nila yan eh. Yung nakikita namin natin dun is only a wax figure. Better looking than Lenin, but at least a wax figure pa rin. And the other thing is that I want to say is the rich, according to F. Scott Fitzgerald, they are different from you and me. They think differently. And talking about the Cojuangcos and the Aquinos and the Marcoses, you can just imagine 12 years of Aquino could not straighten out the problems that the Marcoses have done to us. And I will give you an example only less than 48 hours after the EDSA thing, mga 26 or 27 February of 1986. We went out to the business establishments of Cocoy Romualdez to find out what is happening there so that we can, of course, subject it to say sure, dahil sa martial law, halos na rin tayo noon. Yeah. Alam mo ba, in each of those 40-plus establishments, nailipat niya na kay Lopa. Nailipat niya.
Pakiulit nga po.
Ang perspective niyan is, Lopa was a victim of Cocoy. Marami siyang kinuha kay Lopa during the time na malakas sila. Pero nung umalis na sila, 2 days after EDSA, we went around to these establishments na hawak ni Cocoy. Lahat yon na permahan na ni Lopa at saka ni Romualdez. So, these people talk a different grammar, they talk a different language. Nagkakaintindihan sila. So, bakit nakalusot ang mga Marcoses? Dahil ang mga kuhuhang ko pumayag. Ganun lang. Kasimple. Para sa akin, pinayagan ng mga Marcos dahil sa mayroon din silang interest. So long as we have politicians who have their own self-interest in mind and they have their own personal agendas, we will be, the Filipinos will suffer. Ganun ang mangyari.
Okay. So, between oligarchs, the difference is the same.
Parang lawyers yan, sorry. So, parang lawyers yan. Kill, kill, kill. Let's kill all the lawyers, sabi ni, ni Shakespeare.
So I heard. Okay, now, let's look forward. Is there anything we can learn from history that we should really seriously consider to keep the country, you know, from the doldrums, malayo sa paghihirap? Congressman.
I think that we should once and for all really define the kind of relations that we are going to have with each other. How are we going to run this country? I don't think it's really important to have a new structure. I think we have to decide once and for all. Ano ba talaga yung basehan natin ng pagpili ng ating mga leaders? We have to clean up ourselves before we can really say we can progress or do something better.
Would you not allow Smartmatic to get into the picture next time?
My God.
Hindi naman kailangan yung Smartmatic kung malinis lang tayo maglaro ng ating, kung gusto talaga natin palitan yung ating sistema. Eh.
From a historian's point of view.
There are many arguments, especially nowadays, no? Some people were saying that, oh, for traffic at EDSA, martial law tayo, ganun, no? And I was, and there was one driver, that the taxi driver I was with, and I was telling him, you know what, I don't really agree that discipline is what the Philippines needs, no? What I think the Philippines needs is a lack, is a vision, is a community, a sense of community, okay? Because if you try to impose discipline without a sense of community, your people will just find a way to take advantage of it, okay? And we've had that during the time of martial law already before, but people took advantage. You know, those who could take advantage took advantage. So you have doctors using ambulances to go to parties and so on and so forth, okay? But it's a sense of community. Like, for example, if you go to a country like Japan, there is no fear, okay? But people are respectful of each other. And I think that's what we have to build that thing. It's okay, it's a bunch of motherhood statements, okay? But the thing is, we have to build that. We have to start from small, simple things, okay? Little islands, okay, of excellence. And coming from Marikina, that nice city, okay, was built through a way of yes, establishing building, but also by building a sense of community. That's what Bayani did, okay? When he set up that, when he set up his reforms in that city, of course he implemented ordinances, okay, and so on and so forth, instill rules and regulations. But at the same time, he built a sense of community among the Marikenos, which was identifying angkan ni ano to, angkan, you are part of Marikina. So those are the things, okay, and it was a very successful LGU experiment, because up to now you don't have the Fernandez anymore. You have several mayors ready after him, and it was able, they were able to institutionalize it. And Marikenos tend to have a sense of community.
Yun ang mahalaga. All right. Please. What are your thoughts about this? What can we do para umunlad naman ang Pilipinas?
Wala, corny ako dyan eh. Love of country lang. Love of country. If we can sense a certain level of love for our country in our fellow men and in ourselves, malaking bagay. Kasi nung nasa Korea ako mga late 70s, you know, Korea was actually a poor country. Really. They had a 7-story hotel where the elevators operated only 4 or 5 hours. If you arrive with after those hours, you have to walk all the way up with your, you know. And the rooms had, I think, 5 watts yung ilaw. And if you go to the toilet, it's even less. I find a hard time looking for my, for my friend because it's dark. Hanapin mo pa madilim. So, and then they, why are you doing all of this? I just left Ayala the other day and it was full of lights, December. Kasi we are going to have a crisis. And this was early 70s, di pa, wala pang mga crisis. No? They said we are going to have an energy crisis and we have to prepare. And then, of course, legendary yung nung nagkaroon sila ng problema,
yung mga babae, yung mga hikaw nila, nilagay sa bulsa. Walang listahan yun. Nilagay lang sa collection, ano, para lang yung economy nila. And these are things that impress me that I like the Filipinos because they smile, they are very helpful, they are generous, they are hospitable. But why is it that, for instance, in New York, there is a Marinduque club, there is a Ilocos club, there is a Ilocano club. For each province, may club eh.
Walang national identity.
Walang national identity. There is nobody saying, Filipino ako, I love the Philippines.
And now there are people talking about federalism.
Federalism, as observed here, I think, is not the be-all. Maganda rin maano yun, pero yung, tinanong mo kasi ako, kaya nasagot kita. Yung pagmamahal natin sa bayan, yun ang gusto ko.
Ang problema kasi, kung merong pagmamahal sa bayan, at kung titingnan mo rin kung sino sa gobyerno ang merong green cards.
Jesus Christ, he's pointing at me. The thing is, yung masasabi ko kasi sa atin is that, again, from a historical perspective, we are a colonial creation. And any colonial creation, any country that is a colonial creation, has the seeds of break up in it. You look around you, any country that is artificially created, either as a result of war or as a result of colonial conquest, no? Like war. A good example here is Yugoslavia. It was a creation following the First World War when the Austrian-Hungarian Empire was broken up and then you created Yugoslavia out of so many nationalities. That country did not survive 70 years. It broke up, okay? A very good example of that is the sense of regionalism was so strong in that country that when the Germans invaded it in 1941, they called their invasion an exercise. It was like a military exercise. They had no opposition at all. They were just going from one town to another, occupying one town after another. The Yugoslavian army just disintegrated. So, like I said, there's a need to take that into consideration when you talk about political political administrative innovations in the Philippines. You first have to assess really, what is the Philippine nation state? Okay, what is its makeup? What are the flaws? What are the weaknesses in it? And I think in this case, the current administration has in the past 4 months, we have seen what are the ailments in the Philippine nation state as a viable nation state. And that's why I think that's where all the concerns are coming in when it comes to federalism. Because remember, Yugoslavia was a federal state also, okay? So those are the things that... So there are two things that this can happen from, if you look forward. Either the country becomes a successful federal state like Malaysia, or it can go the way of Yugoslavia and just break up. Because remember, we do have an existing armed... an army here that is secessionist in nature.
Uh-huh. Congressman.
Yeah, I fully agree. I don't know what is the purpose of federalism, but I think it's going to break up us some more. Kasi ang mangyayari dyan, kanya-kanya na tayo eh. So why don't we, instead of federalism, ba't hindi tayo bumalik dun sa pinaka-basic? Tribu-tribu na lang tayo.
Wala na rin eleksyon.
Wala na rin eleksyon. Tribu na.
Kung sino yung pinakamalakas.
Tribu namin, tribu.
Kung sino yung pinakamalakas, yun ang mabubuhay.
Oo, wala eh.
Wala nang eleksyon.
Yeah.
Wala lalampas sa guhit na to.
Yeah, but that,
lalampas sa guhit na to, mamamatay.
That sense of nationhood and community aspect is really very important. Ayun lang eh.
Okay.
It's the only way.
Last question for the three of you. Are you optimistic that the peace efforts of the Duterte administration will succeed sa mga Muslim at sa mga nasa kaliwa? Congressman.
I'm crossing my fingers now he will, but I'm also at the same time, I think I'm not a pessimist, but at the rate it is being conducted, mukhang hindi na take up yung lahat ng kailangan na malalaman ng mga concerned parties. Eh. So I think it will hold for the next 2-3 years, but after that we go back to base one again.
Please, from a historical point of view.
Oh God. History has not been optimistic about peace processes, okay? Recently, we had that situation in Colombia that despite all of the investment of the colonial Colombian government together with the FARC and even international support to it, the referendum just rejected the peace process just like that, okay? So there are many, many variables. In the case of the BBL, of the previous administration, became a political issue, okay, of so many factions that it practically died in the, well, it literally just stopped in the water, okay. So the boat just stopped in the water in the case of BBL. So you can see there's so many factors here that can affect a peace process. And in the case of our country, we are talking about two distinct rebel organizations here, with their separate. Separate objectives, okay, and differing, okay. One is secessionism, the other one is the CPP-NPA, and then the CPP-NPA has a totally different makeup of how it conducts negotiations with the government. And all you need to do is just look at historical accounts of countries engaged in communist of suppression of communist insurgencies and how successful they have been in. Forging a peace treaty, and you will see that not always, okay? It's 50-50. And because, you know, the most important thing is that a peace process needs to have a whole-of-government approach, okay? And in a whole-of-government approach, you have all the agencies working hand-in-hand, okay? To establish for example, the conditions of peace, okay? And when you have conditions of peace, you do that also in partnership with international organizations. And that is why, in the past 4 months, we will really need to see, the administration really has to assess its foreign policy objectives, because a large part also of development programs in support of peace negotiations comes from European countries, to be exact.
Thank you very much.
Yung recent na lang ni Ms. Wari, binigyan niya siya ng lahat na, pinasalita na siya ng matagal, lahat, for his cooperation. What did he do the following day? As long as the MILF is there, I am not taking part in anything. That's really cutting it down at the root when the president was trying to him to come up with a more conciliatory participation. Ms. Warikas is under pressure from the Young Turks of the MNLF. Mga bata ito, mga magagaling, at mga agresibo, ayaw nilang pagbigyan ang MILF, because yung MILF, compromised na yan eh. Hawak ng US eh. Kaya ayaw nila yung MILF. So, these are the niceties that I don't know how it works. But that is my comment on the Muslim problem. My comment on the komunista, nagtanong ako, kasi gusto ko, paano kayo nakaupo? Sino ang nasa center? Ganun? Bakit nandyan bigla si Fidel Aguawili? Sino ba siya? Kasi in the negotiations, you have to have a certain steps. I don't like to be sound bookish, but there are steps that you take so that pagka nagkagulo o magkaroon ng problema, mayroon kayong pabalik na conflict resolution. We don't even know who is who in that group. Kasi bigla na lang nag-step aside si Halandone. And we all know that Joma Sison is no longer anything. And why did we talk to him? And then all of a sudden, Fidel Aguawili is there. Who is he? How did they sit? Wala tayong video kahit ano. Wala tayong minutes. Totoo ba yun? So, how can you negotiate like that? Ganun lang.
So parang may isang tao, si Joma Sison, na wala ng control dito sa nagaganap sa bansa.
Of course not. The NPA and Negros don't follow the commands of Joma Sison anymore. They have their own set of young leaders.
Okay. All right. Balikan ko lang. Yung MILF also has its own young leaders who may as well be fundamentalists, just like the MNLF.
Yes, pero mas
mas ano sabihin what respetado takot ako dito sa mga bata na NLF
kasi
hindi sila maingay eh. Hindi sila maingay pero many of them are educated abroad and they are also supported by countries from the Middle East and the MILF is not exactly the MILF used to have support before through Ms. Wari Panuni kasi sabi kay Ms. Wari bigyan mo naman ng MILF mga MILF naman si sino ba yun si Salamat yata yun yung
Salamat
talked with a US president may mga exchanges sila and in the letter of the MILF they promised to make Mindanao available to the Americans because Mindanao is such a big price kahit na saan ka lang pumunta doon at saka dumura o kaya tumusok merong kang makuha
okay
so ganun and the Americans it's a good distance from the it's a distance that is good enough from the Chinese mainland for the ICBMs, mga ganon, medyo mahirap, mas malaki ang probability error pag nandun ka. So maraming okay. mga advantages.
Pero magpagulo yung ano, young ISIS. Yung mga bata na ISIS.
Oo, yun.
Ayun ang,
Iba pa yun.
And that's a new group in Mindanao that's really very aggressive.
So, in so far as that is concerned, I really cannot see clearly what the president is doing. That's all I can say.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank everyone who took time out to be with us. Maraming salamat po. It's indeed a pleasure to have you with us. And we look forward to more discussions. Magandang araw po. Magandang tanghali sa ating lahat. Thank you very much for keeping us company.